Now, this issue about Indian history has now become quite a hot topic. In fact, has been for a few years now. And I'm going to give you a flavor of why I think there is a very good case for beginning to rethink Indian history. And the line that I love using is an African saying, which basically goes as follows. Until the lions have their own storytellers, the history of the hunt will always glorify the hunter. So until we learn to tell our own story and continue to think of ourselves in the ways others define us, we will continue to be their slaves. So it's very important that we tell our own story. But there is a real problem. That 70 years after independence, we still do not tell our own story. And when we do, there are enormous biases in this. So what I'm going to try and do is to give you some sense of the kinds of bias. They're not the only kinds of bias there. There are many others. But I'll give you some sense of the big ones. Now, the first and most obvious bias of Indian history is that most of the textbook history that you have been forced to read, and I was also forced to read, is not the history of India. It is the history of Delhi. So you and I have been forced to memorize the names of large numbers of kings of Delhi, including obscure dynasties like the Lodhis. And yet, there are large parts of the country which are not even mentioned in our history narrative. So unless you happen to be from Tamil Nadu, you probably never heard or know very little about the Cholas and Pallavas. You probably heard very little, unless you happen to be from the Northeast, about the great Ahom kings who ruled over that part of the country for 600 years. You probably not heard much about Lalitaditya, who stood up, the Kashmiri king, who set up this huge empire in the north of India. You probably not heard of Satvahanas, the Chalukyas. So the problem here is that essentially we have left out the narrative of India almost entirely. And God forbid you happen to be coming from some place like Goa or Sikkim, you do not even exist in the history book. So this is a very major problem. India needs to grab back its narrative from Delhi. So this is the first most important thing that we need to do. The second very important thing we need to do is to recognize that a large part of the way we think of our narrative is even today, 70 years after independence, heavily dominated by the way the colonial rulers had told the story. We have just, without updating it, blindly continued with the stories. Have you noticed that when you're reading your history books, that no matter when the battle happens, the Indians always lose? Have you noticed that? So the three battles of Panipat, Indians lose. Battle of Buxar, Indians lose. Battle of Tarain, Indians lose. Battle of Plassey, Indians lose. So now, surely, given that we are still here, we must have won some battles at least. But those battles were, and our successes were simply systematically removed from our narrative. And so, as a result, we have been left with this impression that we never won anything and we are a bunch of losers who were always meant to be colonized by somebody else. This is essentially a narrative that a colonizer was telling us in order to dominate us. And yet we have imbibed it to such an extent that we do not even think about it. So for example, we all know about Mahmud Ghazni and Muhammad Ghori. And you get the impression from reading our history books that, you know, one of them came and a few years later the other one came. But in fact, the last invasion of Mahmud Ghazni happened in 1025. Mahmud Ghori turned up in 1192. There was a 175-year difference between the two. So why was there such a long, big difference? The reason for that is very simple. In 1033, the nephew of Muhammad Ghazni raced down from the Afghan mountains and he fought his way through to the Gangetic plains where he was met by a local king. The king's name was Suhail Deo Pasi. And in 1033 in the Battle of Baharaich, Suhail Dev Pasi completely destroyed the army, the Turkic army that had come. And the massacre was so big that for 175 years after that, the Turks didn't dare to come back. Now this has been wiped out of our history books. And there are many, many such. I'll give you another. How many of you here from Kerala? So now, except for you, let's see how many people have heard of Martanda Varma. So if you're not from Kerala and you've heard of Martanda Varma, raise your hand. Very, very few people. Now, Martanda Varma is not an important person only in Indian history. He was an important person in world history. So let me rewind you back to the early 18th century. In the early 18th century, what was going on? The Dutch East India Company was the most powerful maritime power in the world. In fact, they had conquered what is now Indonesia. They had conquered South Africa. They had conquered Sri Lanka. And it looked like it was only a matter of time before they began to take over India. When they came across a man called Martanda Varma, who was the king of a very small kingdom in the southern tip of India. And in a battle called the Battle of Kolachal, on the beach, he completely destroyed the Dutch. And he defeated them so badly that from that point onwards, the Dutch East India Company went into decline. Now this was a major, major event. Because but for this event, I would be giving you this talk in Dutch. And not only that, the decline of the Dutch East India Company is what allowed the English East India Company to come up. So it was a world event. And from that point, and I think this battle was fought in 1732, if I'm not mistaken, and then till 1905, when the Japanese defeated the Russians, no Asiatic power defeated a European power. Now, even Indian textbooks talk about the Japanese defeating the Russians. Worldwide, everybody knows that 1905, Japanese defeated the Russians. But even Indian textbooks don't tell you that the previous to that, the last guy who had done it was Martanda Varma. Just imagine. We have wiped this fellow off our memory. In most other places, he would be there in every other. So similarly, in Assam, did you know that at the height of the Mughal Empire, when the Mughals invaded Assam, the Assamese managed to coax the Mughal army onto a naval battle on the Brahmaputra, where a general called Lasit Borphukan completely destroyed the Mughal invaders. Again, unless you happen to be from Northeast, you probably never heard of Lasit Borphukan. And these are just individuals. There are entire empires that have been wiped out of our memory. So from our textbooks, you will get the impression that the Mughals ruled India, and then a few years later, the British took over India. What they don't tell you is that there is a fairly long gap between the two, and that for something like 70 years, a large part of India was ruled by the Marathas. In fact, they ruled India from Punjab all the way to southern India to Tamil Nadu. Now, this was a huge empire. In fact, their empire was larger than that of Akbar. And yet, the Maratha period has been wiped out. Why? Because it was an inconvenient period to the British narrative that foreigners have always ruled India. In fact, they were so keen on this narrative, they invented a completely fictitious invasion called the Aryan invasion theory to basically tell us that, look, this civilization you're very proud of is actually also a gift from some white people. And all we are doing by conquering you is giving you a software update. So the net result of this is that our narrative has now got to be captured back and rewritten by ourselves. So this is the second major problem in our narrative. The problem was after we became independent, rather than correct these narratives, a new group of rulers came about and they wanted to add in their narratives. They were both, of course, there was the Congress Party and the Gandhi dynasty specifically. And of course, in the intellectual spaces, they were the Marxists. And what they did is that they inserted their own biases into the story. So I'll just give you one example of it. Now, if you were reading the history of the India's freedom struggle from the British, you would get the impression that it was a uniquely peaceful fight for independence, which led by Mahatma Gandhi and the Congress. And the story would go to give you the impression that, you know, we politely asked the British to leave and they very graciously left. Problem is that this is not the real story. There were many other movements to liberate India from British rule, including several which were armed revolts. Now, because it's still in fairly recent history, people still know the names of a few of them, like Bhagat Singh. You'll have heard of Udham Singh, perhaps, maybe of Chandrashekhar Azad and a few others. But the impression you get is that these are random people carrying out some random acts of individual bravery, and that really it had no real impact on the overall story. That is actually not true. The revolutionaries were an organized group of people starting in the 1910s who had embassies in the First World War in places like Japan and Berlin, who organized major efforts like the Gadar movement. Please read about all these. That they were, during the Second World, of course, thanks to Subhash Bose's INA, you know a little bit about. But, you know, other than these random things, you don't understand that many of the people who participated in this were the same people with the same agenda working together over a long period, 40, 50 years. And that is simply left out of the story. So you give the impression that they were individual acts of bravery and nothing else. Whereas this story can be told in a completely different way, incidentally, and it gives you a very, very different impression of why, in the end, India became independent, culminating in, of course, the 1946 when you had the naval revolt in Bombay. It had nothing to make with making salt. Now, that is a totally different story, wiped out of our memory. I am personally slowly researching this story. And it's an extraordinary story of espionage and individual courage and so on. So hopefully in a couple of years' time, you'll be able to read this story. But the point I'm making to you is this is another bias. And I'm going to finish with the last bias that I think is that women have been wiped out of our history books again. This is astonishing because unlike the histories of many other parts of the world, Indian history is actually full of powerful, interesting women. This is unique. And yet we don't hear very much about them. How many history books tell you about Ahilya Bai Holkar? Or the great resistance of Durgavati to Akbar? Or the resistance of the three Ranis Abakka of Ullal who fought against the Portuguese? And of course, the only one you probably hear about is Rani Jhansi, Lakshmi Bai. And even that is not because of your history books, but because of that poem that all of you had to learn in Hindi class in class 7. So, the point here is this. We need to put a very large proportion of our population back into the history books. Half of the population has simply been wiped out. And yet, India is unique in having sizable parts of the country run by matriarchal societies. Some of them are matriarchal even today. Very powerful queens, very unlike many other parts of the world. We had many, many, over long periods of time, many powerful queens. Enormous contributions to different things, from religious texts to science to literature. It's just amazing, and yet we have wiped all of this out of our memory. So this is just a sort of a grand smattering of why we need to rewrite our history books. With that, let me hand the mic back.